Okay, so we're looking at the type binding method. So this is the type binding method for finding the band structure. So in other words, can you all hear me?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Right, so we are trying to solve the problem of non-interacting electrons in a periodic potential. Non-interacting electrons in a periodic potential. And what we have done is we have started from the atomic basis. Atomic orbital basis. Then, using this, we have constructed a block state. Okay. Then, this we substitute into the Schrodinger's equation. And what comes out is a system of homogeneous linear equations. And the solution of this, the solution yields eigenvalues, which is basically the dispersion, that is Ek, and eigenvectors, which are the block states. Okay, so that's basically the scheme of things, right? We start from the atomic orbital basis. So let's say you want to consider the band formed by the s orbitals. So you would take the s orbitals and then form a block state by superposition. And the superposition was done in a special way. We basically what we did was we took B alpha e to the power I k dot r m alpha and then chi m alpha. So there was a sum over m and there was a sum over alpha, right? So this was the kind of a block state. And what we are trying to do is to solve this problem. The H atomic plus delta U operating on psi k should give us the dispersion this. Okay. And when we took this ansatz, or when we took this linear superposition and substituted into this, then we got a system of linear equations for the parameters b. Okay, so this is what we saw last time, and we very quickly towards the end of the class we had done the monatomic 1D lattice, which we'll go over it once again now. And what we saw was that the dispersion was not free electron-like. Okay, so the dispersion that we found out from there was something like a cos ka, and you'll see how different that is. Okay. So, was there any doubt in the last class? Because I'm going to start from the equation that we had obtained in the last class, and we will proceed from there. So, let me write down the equation, then we'll see how much you guys remember. So, what we had got was Ek minus E beta and then B beta plus sum over M alpha not equal to N beta B alpha e to the power I k dot R M alpha minus R N beta and then chi N beta chi M alpha. This is equal to B beta e to the power I k dot r n beta chi n beta delta u. Let me just write this. It's a little bit of a long equation, but this is the equation that should be the starting point of any band structure calculation that you want to do. So let's say I give you a complicated lattice, let's say a ladder, a 1D ladder problem, or let's say the Kagome lattice or a simple cubic lattice in 2D. Okay, so hexagonal lattice, for example, or graphene lattice, honeycomb lattice. So any lattice that anybody gives you, if you want to find the tight binding band structure, then this is the equation that you need to start from. Yes.
The first term of LHS, shouldn't there be another exponential e to the power I k dot r p beta?
Yes, one second. So what I am trying to do here is I'll remove this also. Now is this okay? So let me just write this again, one second. So I've taken the, I've divided the whole thing by e to the power I k dot r n beta. So this is p beta and then chi n beta delta u chi n beta. Now is it okay?
Yes.
Yeah. E to the power I k dot r n alpha. Okay. And then chi n beta delta u chi m alpha. Okay. So this is the starting equation. Okay. And it is a complicated looking equation, but actually it is not. If you think about it, it's not complicated at all. Okay. So what we will do is let's just discuss this equation for about 5 minutes. And whom did we not talk to last time? So we didn't talk to Uttam last time. So Uttam, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Uttam, can you explain this equation? Like what is there on the left hand side? What is there on the right hand side? And the individual terms? What are these terms? What is epsilon k, for example?
Sir, this is the energy when we act the total Hamiltonian on psi k, means on block state.
Okay. So that is something that we want to get, right? That is the dispersion.
Yeah. So okay. The eigenvalue will be energy Ek.
Okay. What is E beta?
And this is for a particular state when suppose this is for a localized state. Okay. Any particular
the atomic energy.
Yeah.
Right. So yeah. when we take the H atomic and then yes, act sir. It on the atomic state chi m chi n yes, beta, sir. We would get E beta. Correct.
Yes.
Okay. So this is the eigenvalue of the H atomic Hamiltonian. Okay. Then what is B beta?
Sir, again, this is the coefficient of that particular.
Very good.
In the okay. expansion of the whole
of the block
wave.
Yeah. Yes. Very good. So the B beta is the coefficient of the betath orbital, right? When we do yes, the expansion sir. Of the block state. Very nice. Mm-hmm. Now, on the left hand side, we see a chi n beta chi m alpha, right? You see yes. a scalar product.
Yes. Sir.
Okay. So do you think that would be significant?
In what sense?
Do you think that would be okay? So how significant do you think that would be? When
sir, that will depend on means which neighbor means is it nearest neighbor or
exactly exactly. So what we are saying here is that m alpha is not equal to n beta. So either m is not equal to n or alpha is not equal to beta. Correct?
Yes. Sir.
And m and n are what indices? Which indices are these m's and n's?
M and n, sir, they are means unit cell.
Very nice. Yeah. Okay. So they are not site indices, right?
No, they just describe particular unit cell, first unit cell, second unit cell.
Very nice, very nice. See, this is a very, very important point, and a lot of people get confused with this, that the M and N are actually unit cell indices and they are not particular site indices. Okay, so let me give a small example here. So if I'm taking, let's say, a diatomic lattice, and this is something that we will consider a little bit later. And let's call this as 1A, 1B, 2A and 2B, 3A and 3B. Okay. Now, normally, when I number the lattice sites, I would number them as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Okay. And this is one unit cell. This is another unit cell. This is the third unit cell and so on. So the m and n correspond to the unit cell index. M is 1, 2, 3, right? And m is not equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. It's not equal to that. So that is very, very important to remember. And corresponding to each unit cell, there are two atoms in a particular cell, and we can label them as A or B. Okay, so very nice. And then beta will be in the same context. What would alpha and beta take?
Basis. They talk about basis.
So in the particular example that we have taken, which is the diatomic 1D lattice, what would be the values that alpha and beta can take?
Alpha will be this is diatomic, so
yes,
there will be one alpha, one beta, like that.
So you can see the drawing that I have made, right? The diatomic lattice.
Yes.
So in this context, what values will alpha and beta take?
We can take alpha to be A or B. Means,
very good. So alpha and beta can be both A and B, right? Very nice. So on the left hand side, we only see the orbital overlaps. Okay. Yeah. So the LHS is basically orbital overlaps. Now, in the same, if we take the same interpretation, the right hand side, does it also contain only orbital overlaps or something more?
Sir, here.
So these matrix elements that you're seeing, are they just orbital overlaps or are they something more? They are the matrix elements, right? They are not directly orbital overlaps.
Yes,
isn't it? So because delta U is a interatomic potential, and we are taking the matrix element in this particular case, this is a diagonal matrix element.
Yes, sir.
Right, and in this case, it is off diagonal.
Yes.
Okay. So these are matrix. In the RHS, we see the matrix elements of the delta U operator. Thanks, Uttam. You can mute yourself. Okay. So that's basically the equation. And the first thing we can do, the simplest problem that we can do, is of a 1D monoatomic lattice with one non-degenerate orbital. Okay. With one non-degenerate orbital. Okay. And let me start now alphabetically. So Ashish, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So let's take a 1D monoatomic lattice, and you take this equation that we have written here, right? That is the basic equation that we have written, and we want to apply this to a 1D monoatomic lattice with one non-degenerate orbital at every site of the lattice, right? So how do I apply this equation now? So why don't you start telling me what I should write?
Sir, it will be Ek minus.
Okay.
If Ek minus E beta.
Okay, so let's call this E. So since there is no alpha beta, right? It's just one orbital. So let's call that E naught. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Okay, good. Ek minus E naught, and then?
And then summation of M not equal to N.
What about B beta? What happens to that?
So it will cancel out from left hand side and right hand side. Then
that's correct, but let's just write it for now. Let's write it as it is. We will then cancel
out. Then it will be B naught.
Just B naught. Okay, fine. And then
plus summation of M not equal to N.
Okay.
A to the power B zero. A to the power iota K Rm minus Rn.
Okay, because alpha index is not there now. It's all single orbital. And then?
Yes, sir. And then inner product of chi n and chi m.
Very nice. And on the right hand side, it will be again B0, right?
Yes, sir. B0 and delta u and chi n and chi n.
Okay, the second term?
Plus summation m not equal to n.
Okay.
B zero.
Yes.
E to the power iota k rm minus rn.
Okay.
And this matrix element for delta u, chi n and chi m.
Chi n, very nice. Okay. Thanks, Ashish. You can mute yourself. Now, Anustup, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, Anustup, now tell me something. There is a chi n, chi m here, right?
Yes, sir.
Now, do you think it will have some sort of a systematic behavior as we move away from the nth site? See, remember the summation is over m, right? And we are taking matrix elements here between chi n and chi m. So the nth orbital or the nth unit cell orbital and the mth unit cell orbital, right? So do you think this will be more significant, closer to the nth site and then decrease as we go away from that?
Yes, sir.
Right? So this is a kind of an overlap element, right? And because these are all localized orbitals. Yes, you're saying something?
It should be a direct delta function.
It should be?
A direct delta function.
Direct delta function. This is not a direct delta function. In fact, this is not even Kronecker delta. Okay, so see, the direct delta function comes in when you have continuous indices. Here we have n and m, and n and m are integral indices. Okay, so this could have been a Kronecker delta. However, it turns out that even if you try to design something called maximally localized Wannier functions, okay, there is a term called maximally localized Wannier functions, even these have extent of about 2 to 3 lattice spacings. Okay, so it's a good approximation to take it as a Kronecker delta. Okay, but if you take it realistically, then the nearest neighbor overlap and even the next nearest neighbor overlap is actually not zero. Okay, so that is something that we need to remember. So let's take here the nearest neighbor overlap only. Okay, you understand what I'm saying?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so let's take chi n plus 1, okay, and is equal to some, let's say, t. And then chi n plus 1, sorry, n minus 1 and chi n also equal to this is equal to t. Let's not call it t, let's call it some w or something. See, in this whole problem, you have to make sure that you use symbols very properly because there are so many different quantities. Okay, so this is, we will consider only nearest neighbors, and that is an approximation that we are making. And we will truncate all the matrix elements beyond the nearest neighbors. Okay. So then on the right hand side, let's do again exactly the same thing. Right. So if we do that, then we will restrict ourselves only to m equal to n plus 1 or n minus 1. Okay. Anasup, are you?
Hello, sir.
Yes.
In realistic case, if we take the inner product of chi n and chi m, will it be some exponential kind of function which decays very rapidly?
It does. So, but what happens is most likely it's not an exponentially dying function. It could be, for example, a sink kind of a function. It is not a monotonically decaying function. Okay, it could be an oscillatory decaying function.
Okay.
And it depends on, for example, which orbital you are considering. So I'll give you an example. Suppose you take these transition metals. And in these transition metals, what could happen is that the outer s orbital as well as the outer d orbital, both of them could be active. Okay. So in that case, what happens is that the s orbital of one transition atom and the s orbital of the other transition atom, they could have a strong overlap. In fact, even the second nearest neighbor also could have a strong overlap. However, the d orbital, because it is closer to the nucleus, the d orbital, the 3d, for example, could have a much less overlap even with the neighboring one. Forget the next nearest neighbor. Okay. So depending on what kind of orbital you are considering, you will find that the overlap changes with the neighbors. And that turns out to be a very crucial thing, because the strength of the overlap determines the bandwidth. And if a band is wide, then it turns out the material is, to a very good approximation, consists of non-interacting electrons. If the band turns out to be very narrow, then it turns out that correlation effects are very important. Okay, so there is a lot of physics in this, which there is a lot of these matrix elements, for example, determine a lot of physics, right? The even at the non-interacting level, if you can see that the bands are either narrow or wide, you can actually predict whether the material is going to be correlated or uncorrelated.
Okay, sir. And sir, how to know which orbitals will be active and which will be not?
So usually what we do is we, that comes from some chemistry knowledge. One says that, okay, there is probably the outermost shells which have, which are not filled. Okay, the partially filled outer shells, they will be the ones which will participate in band formation. If you have completely filled shells, then usually you consider that as a core part, which does not take part in band formation. Okay.
Okay,
does
sir.
That answer the question? Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay. Right. So let's take this only the nearest neighbors. And in that case, yeah. So Anustup, you can mute yourself. We'll move on to the next person. So Disha, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Disha, can you tell me what should I write now? So I've taken chi n plus 1 overlap as W, and chi n minus 1 chi n also as W. And let's consider this chi n, this one here, okay, as let's call it as TD, okay, and let's call this as TOD. So this will become TD nearest neighbor, this will become NM. So why don't you tell me what I should write here? What is the next step?
E to the power I k dot rm minus rn, you can reduce it down.
Yes, that's true. But if I start from the left hand side, I should start writing with ek minus e0, right?
Yeah.
And the b0, will it remain now? It will cancel out, right?
Yeah, it will cancel out from on both the sides.
Then what should I write here? 1 plus?
1 plus. You just have to consider those two terms if you're considering nearest neighbor.
Correct. In the 1D lattice, so, there are only two nearest neighbors, right? This and this. So if this is n, then this is n minus 1 and there is n plus 1. Okay. And what will be rm minus rn?
It'll be A.
So it'll be either minus A or A.
Right? Or minus A.
So if m is n minus 1, then this will become minus A. If m is n plus 1, this will become plus A. Correct?
Yes, yeah.
Okay. So
you can address cos.
Correct. So 2w cos ka is what we will get. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. And what will we get on the right hand side?
Then it will be tnn.
Okay. T diagonal nn. Yes.
Yeah. Plus 2 cosh ka t n m o d.
Okay. So cosh the structure is very similar on both sides, right?
Yeah.
Why will this be cosh?
The same thing.
The same thing, right? So okay. Yeah. So I heard that as cos. So I thought you are saying cos hyperbolic.
No, cos.
Yeah. Okay. So thanks. You can mute yourself. So ek is e naught plus t diagonal nn, and we can take out this subscript nn because the delta u is basically a periodic function. So for any n, this will be the same. and we can write this as t diagonal plus 2t off diagonal cos ka divided by 1 plus 2w cos ka. Okay, so this is the dispersion that we get for a monotonic, sorry, for a monoatomic 1D lattice. Now it turns out that the w is actually much less than 1. Okay, and it's in the denominator. So what really matters then is the t off diagonal. Okay, so this whole thing, if we take this approximation that mod w is much less than 1, then ek will turn out to be basically e naught bar minus 2t cos ka. And I'll tell you why I have written it as this form, minus 2t. And what I'm assuming here is TOD is minus T. Okay. So just take a note of this and let me explain to you why I have written it this way. Okay, so wait. Right. So the reason why, well, this has gone out of the screen, I don't know why, but so EK is E naught bar minus 2T cos KA, where I've assumed that T off diagonal is minus T. Okay, so Gautam, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Gautam, where would be the band minimum for this dispersion?
At k equal to 0.
K equal to 0, right? So yes. If I draw the EK versus K, then what would be the value at the band minimum?
E0 bar minus 2t.
Correct. So let's call this as the E0 bar. Okay. So with respect to E0 bar, we are basically saying that it is minus 2t. That is the band minimum, right?
Yes, sir.
And where is the band maximum?
At the brilliant zone, that is the cos k equal to 0.
K equal to 0. K equal to 0, you just told me it's a band minimum, right?
Yes.
So k equal to pi.
Yes, k equal to pi.
And minus pi by 8, that's where the maximum will be, and the maximum will be plus 2t, right?
Yes.
So this is how the dispersion looks like. Correct?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So does everybody understand this? If you don't, please let me know. Now, what is the bandwidth of this particular band? So do you understand the term bandwidth?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so what is the bandwidth of this band?
So I think we have to put EK equal to
EK equal to?
From that point.
Okay, so let me explain what the term bandwidth means, and then you can tell me what is the bandwidth. So first of all, okay, this is a band of energies, because for every K value from minus pi by A to pi by A, there is a continuum of energies. So remember, when we had started this problem with isolated atoms, there were discrete levels to begin with, and those discrete levels were the E zeros. Okay, of the individual atom. Once they started overlapping with each other, then we got a continuous band of energies. Okay, so the EKs, remember, are the eigenvalues of the full problem. And for each K, we get a different EK. Now, the EK maximum minus EK minimum, is called the bandwidth. Okay, so what is the maximum value that for a particular band the EK can take, and what is the minimum value it can take? If you subtract both those two, what you will get is basically the width of the band. Okay, so in that, using that definition, can you tell me what is the bandwidth?
Hello.
So the bandwidth will be 40.
Yes, sir. So we can
so
ask.
The bandwidth will be 40.
Very good. Yeah. So bandwidth is 40. Okay, Gautam. Thanks. Yeah, Shovik, you can ask.
Hello, sir.
Yes.
Sir, can you just repeat from E7k equals to E0 plus that function, because I was left out because there was very slow internet connection due to cloud.
Oh, okay. Fine.
So just in brief.
Yeah, one second. Let me just put this for charging. Okay, so basically what I was saying, Shovik, was that this dispersion is E0 bar minus 2t cos ka, and I was going to explain why I have taken this t off diagonal to be minus t and not plus t. So what Gautam did was he helped us to plot this function. The minimum turned out to be at k equal to 0, which was minus 2t, which is the center of the Brillouin zone, and the maximum turned out to be at the edge of the Brillouin zone. Okay, and you can see that if we had taken the t off diagonal to be a positive value, to be plus t, then what would have happened is at the zone center we would have got a maximum, and at the zone edges we would have got a minimum. Okay, so just to avoid that, okay, just as a convention, we have chosen t off diagonal to be equal to minus t. Okay, so that is the conventional way in which this is written, so that the minimum of the band occurs at the zone center. Okay, and what we also discussed is the width of a particular band, and the width is given by what is the maximum value that the band energy can take, and what is the minimum value that a band energy can take. So that was plus 2t and minus 2t. So the band width is given by 4t. Okay, so that is basically what we discussed. Is that clear, Shovik? So we will take up the concept of the density of states in the next class, but what we will do now is apply this same equation to a diatomic lattice. Okay, and before we do that, we will review what we had seen in the case of phonons, because there is a nice parallel here in terms of phonons and electrons. And to do that, we will use the help of Rishikesh. Are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Rishikesh, you remember in the case of phonons, when we had a monoatomic 1D lattice, how many branches did we get?
Sir, two.
Two branches.
Hello?
Yeah. So for a monoatomic 1D lattice, how many branches did we get?
Optical and acoustic.
No, if you had only one atom per unit cell, you will actually get only one branch. Okay, if it is a 1D one atom basis, you will only get one branch. But if you had two atoms per basis, okay, if it's a diatomic lattice, only then you can get an optical branch also.
Okay, sir.
So the thing is, now here we saw that if we had a monoatomic 1D lattice, we got one band of energies. Okay, and this band of energies is equivalent to the branch of the phonons, Because remember, for each branch of phonons, we have a certain dispersion. Similarly here, for each band of electron energies, we will have a certain dispersion. If you consider a different band, the dispersion can be different. Okay. So let me explain that by taking again the example of phonons. So Rishikesh, what have I drawn here?
The dispersion and the band.
Dispersion, right? Omega k versus k, right? Yeah. Okay. And yes, do you remember the form of the optical dispersion? What is the dependence of omega k on k?
Omega square is equal to 4. Sine square.
To?
Yeah. Sine square k.
By 2, right? So omega k itself like mod sine k a by 2, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in the case of electrons, we see that the Ek is proportional to cos Ka. Okay. So you see something similar happening here, correct? Okay. Yes, in fact, sir, we have written it as a minus cos Ka. So you see something similar happening in the case of phonons and electrons, that phonons have a dispersion again for the acoustic branch. And then there is a minimum at the zone center. So, and we have chosen the Hopping parameter in such a way that we also get a minimum at the zone center. And for a 1D monoatomic lattice with a single degenerate orbital, single non-degenerate orbital, we get only one branch or one band. Okay. And this is the optical one. Do you know the dispersion of the optical branch?
Sir, I don't remember. Sorry.
Yeah, it's not easy to remember. Okay. In fact, if you had a diatomic lattice, then the dispersion of the acoustic branch is also not exactly sine ka by 2. Okay. It's actually more complicated, and these two turn out to be the solutions of an eigenvalue equation of a 2 by 2 determinant. Okay. So you should go back and look it up. Fine?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So in the same way, if we want to see you can mute yourself. In the same way as for phonons, if we want to see a two band system, okay, then we have to have for a 1D lattice a minimum number of two atoms. Okay. And with these two atoms, we should be able to see two different bands which are forming, and we can also see the formation of a band gap, right? And where does the band gap form? What is the nature? What is the magnitude of the band gap? And so on. Okay. So that is what we want to do next. And it's going to be a slightly tedious calculation, but bear with me. At the end, we will make some simplifications and we will get a nice looking result. Okay. So let's start now the problem with a diatomic lattice. It's a 1D diatomic lattice. And again, the idea is very similar. We want to apply exactly the same equation. Okay. So it's this. And the unit cell, we can draw it in this way. Let's call this as the nth unit cell. This is n minus 1. This is n plus 1. And let's call this as A. This is B. This is A, this is B, and so on. And we can take a very general case, but let's make one simplification right away, which is the distance between AB is A, no matter whether it is intra-unit cell or inter-unit cell. Okay. But you can, of course, keep it general. And what will happen is when you take this Rm alpha minus Rn beta, there you can include the fact that the distance between the intra unit cell AB or the inter unit cell AB is not the same. Okay. But just for simplification, we have taken this. All right. So now, Sohini, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So Sohini, can you help me with this, with the 1D diatomic lattice? What will be the values that alpha and beta can take now?
It can take two values.
Correct. It can take values A or B, right?
Yes.
Okay, so let's start writing this equation. Now, this equation here, how many equations do you think are there in this one equation? This is actually not a single equation. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
So how many equations are embedded in this one equation?
Two equations.
Two, very nice. So how will we generate these two equations?
How will we generate?
Yes, how will we? So what I'm seeing here is just one equation, right? And you said actually there are two equations embedded in this, which is the correct answer. So how do I take out the two equations from this one equation? How do I write down two equations from this one equation?
By taking the secular determinant.
That's correct. But to write down the determinant, I need to have two equations, isn't it? Two linear equations. So how do I write those two linear equations in terms of the A, B, the lattice parameter A and so on? How do I expand this one compact equation into two specific equations for the 1D diatomic lattice? So in other words, what I'm saying is that the main equation that you see on the top of the page is valid for any general lattice. Okay, any number of basis atoms, any number of orbitals. So that general equation, we want to write it specifically for a 1D diatomic lattice with the two atoms being represented by A and B. So how do I do it?
By putting the values of beta.
Very nice. Alpha. Very nice. So first we will consider beta equal to A, correct?
Yes.
Okay. Now tell me what I should start writing here.
Ek minus Ea.
Okay. Yes.
Ba plus summation of m alpha not equal to n beta.
Okay. So in this B alpha, right? So how many terms will be there if we consider only nearest neighbor interactions?
There would be two terms.
Correct. So there will be two terms. And what will those two terms be?
One for n plus n and n minus one.
That's correct. So now here, what should I start writing? What will be the B alpha first of all? So this is what you have to pay attention to. So there is a M alpha not equal to N beta, right? So either M is not equal to N or alpha is not equal to beta. Okay. So there are two possible cases. One is when M is equal to N. Okay. So okay. Can M be equal to N but alpha be not equal to beta?
Yes.
It's possible, right? So if we consider this unit cell here, where the unit cell is the same, but there are two different kinds of atoms, correct?
Yes.
So what should be the subscript that I want to write for the intra unit cell guy?
Na.
B.
Nb. B, right? Yes.
Eb. Isn't it?
Yes.
The alpha will become equal to B because the alpha should not be equal to beta.
Yes.
Okay. And then e to the power I k dot
r alpha minus r beta.
And what is that?
A minus r b.
A minus?
R b.
No, it's just A, no?
Yes, because the lattice.
It's just A, right? So this vector symbol is not needed. And for a 1D system, I can just write it as e to the power ika, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And then what should I write here? The chi n beta, chi m alpha, what will that be? So remember,
chi a,
chi a, okay.
A and chi b.
And you're saying this because it's the same unit cell, correct?
Yes.
Okay. So there is n here and there is n here. That is important. And there will there be other terms also? Are there other nearest neighbors? Okay, no. Let me ask you another question first. Okay. So this equation that we are writing is being written, is it for this one or is it for this one? I mean, let me call this as one, let me call this as two. Okay. Am I writing this equation for the atom one or am I writing this equation for the atom two?
For atom one.
Exactly. For the atom one, we have already taken one nearest neighbor, which is on the right hand side of the atom one, which is the type of atom is B, right? Now we will now we have to consider the other nearest neighbor also, isn't it?
Yes.
And the other nearest neighbor is inter-unit cell. It's not intra-unit cell.
Yes.
Correct. So here we will again have to write B with the subscript B. Now what happens to the exponential?
E to the power iota ka.
Is it plus ika?
Minus.
Minus, right? Because we are now going backwards, isn't it? So there will be minus ika, and then what will happen here, Kai?
N alpha minus alpha and n minus 1 beta.
So what is beta and what is alpha here? So what is chi n?
Alpha is a, n a.
No, beta is a. Remember we started with beta equal to a? Right? So this has to be chi n a, and this has to be the m now becomes n minus 1 and alpha becomes b. Do you understand?
Yes.
Okay, good. So this is what we get for the left hand side. Okay. Now quickly tell me on this, on the same lines, right? Now tell me what happens on the right hand side. What is B beta again? It's BA, right?
BA, yes.
Okay. And what is, what are these now? What are these things now? Chi?
Chi NA.
Okay.
Delta U. Chi yes. NA.
Very nice. Then
plus
yes
b
so a, do you see this is going to be exactly these two terms
except that
instead of this chi n a chi n b scalar product we will insert a delta u in between them otherwise it's exact so this term the first term in the main equation the second term in the main equation on the left hand side and the second term in the main equation on the right hand side are almost exactly the same except that the matrix elements here this is just a overlap of the orbitals whereas here it's a matrix element of the delta u operator that's all everything else is the same correct
yes
so we can write this term very quickly so tell me what should I write here
bb
yes
e to the power iota k a
yes
chi of N A
yes.
Delta U chi N B
very nice
plus B B e to the power iota minus iota K A
yes
chi N A delta U chi N minus 1 B
yes thank you yeah you can mute yourself thanks a lot Sonia okay so this is the first equation that we get right And one can see from this that now we have two variables, which are BA and BB. So we will have to write another equation in parallel to this using beta equal to B. Okay. And in doing this, Shomita, are you online? Will help me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So what should I write here, Shomita? So you can see this equation, right? And you can write the second equation immediately looking at this, correct?
Yes.
So, but first tell me, what is the atom for which we are writing this equation?
The atom is number two.
Number two, right. So what should I write? Ek?
Ek minus Eb.
Yes.
Bb.
Okay.
Plus.
Yes.
BA.
Yes.
E to the power I K.
Yes. Okay.
Wait a minute.
No problem.
E to the power I K A.
Yes.
Chi. This will be n chi n plus 1 a.
So be careful. See, if you look at the equation, it starts with chi n beta, right? And beta we have taken here to be a, b.
Oh, sorry. I have missed the line actually.
Chi n b, isn't it?
Yeah.
Chi n b. And what will be on the other side?
This will be chi n plus 1 a.
Very nice. So, because the nearest neighbor of this is basically the next unit cell guy, okay?
Yes.
And then?
And then another will be BB. BA. It will be BA.
So, every B atom has nearest neighbors as the A atoms. And every A atom has two nearest neighbor B atoms. That's correct. So, BA e to the power minus
IKA. E to the power minus IKA.
Okay.
And this will be chi n b.
Okay.
Chi n a.
Very nice. Okay. So now that you have worked this out, the right hand side is now trivial. So tell me quickly, what is the right hand side?
Right hand side is bb.
Okay.
Chi n b delta u chi n b.
Yes.
Plus B A e to the power I K A.
Okay. And all the same things.
Yeah.
Right.
One will be
Chi N B delta U chi N
chi plus N plus one A.
Okay.
And another will be B A e to the power B B e to the power minus sorry B A e to the power minus I K A.
Yes.
Chi N B. Delta U and chi n plus 1.
That's right. Thank you, Shamita. That's fine. Okay, so with all this, we have got these two equations. And what we need to do now is to represent this as a system of linear equations in BA and BB. Okay, so the thing is, this is quite tedious, and I have done this. So let me just write what the final thing is. Okay, so what one gets finally is the following: Ek minus Ea minus Taa diagonal, and here one gets minus of e to the power Ika T diagonal AB plus e to the power minus IKA TAB off diagonal. Okay. And this comes out to be minus of e to the power minus IKA TBA diagonal plus e to the power minus IKA T off diagonal BA. And this is Ek minus Eb minus TBB diagonal. This should be equal to zero. Okay. So this is the equation that we get, which will determine the energy eigenvalues. Okay. So Shomik, are you online? Yes, you are. So Shomik, tell me, can you hear me? Shomik? Hello. Okay.
Hello, sir.
Ha, Shovik, can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So, Shovik, you see that the matrix elements of this determinant or the elements, the off-diagonal elements are actually complex, right?
Yeah.
So, is it possible that I get a complex dispersion which will not be physical, right?
Yes.
So, is it possible that I can get a complex dispersion?
No, sir.
Why?
The complex dispersion means energy should be
real value because it is a measurable quantity.
So energy should be real, right? But I can see that there are, you know, the off-diagonal entries of this determinant are complex. So is it possible that I can get some complex eigenvalues? Or does the structure of this matrix tell you that no, the epsilon k's have to be real?
Sir, when we get the result, then epsilon I, there is plus ik and minus ik. If we if we simplify this, we can turn out in sin k or cos k.
No, that is okay. So you are working it out, but tell me a general property of this matrix which ensures that the eigenvalues will definitely be real. What kind of Hamiltonians do you get in conventional quantum mechanics? What is the property that they have? I'll give
you some Hermitian.
Hermitian, right? Yeah. So you, do you see, Shovik, that this Hamilton, this matrix is actually a Hermitian matrix?
Yeah.
It because is, right?
Diagonal minus ik will be ik.
Correct. So, and we have written this as a determinant, but actually if you remember, we have, what we have done here is this HAA, HAB, HBB, HBA, okay, this, and then there is a BA and there is a BB, that is zero. Okay, in fact, there is a minus EK also here. This is essentially what we are doing.
Excuse me, sir.
Yeah.
Hello.
Yes, yes.
Sir, when we do complex conjugate and transpose, so this HBB, HBA element in this matrix will not be equal to HAB, sir.
This is BA. Sorry, what you are saying?
So HBA element will not be equal to HAB, sir.
Why is that?
I think there is some mistake here. One, at one place, there should be one positive one
minus
IK.
IK reversed. So there is both minus IK in HB.
Oh, yeah, yeah, yeah. Sure. Yes, yes. This should be a plus. That's correct. Absolutely right. Yeah. So only so the complex conjugate of this element of the AB now turns out to be correct, right? So there is a minus here in the first one, in the diagonal part, and in the off diagonal part, it is plus. Now is it okay?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So there is one more thing that I would like to mention here. It's the following. I have taken here only nearest neighbor interactions. Okay, that's one thing. And what I'm going to do here is to make many more simplifications if I want to see this. See a nice closed form solution. Okay, if you solve this problem, you can easily see the dispersion and you are guaranteed real eigenvalues. Okay, but it's hard to make interpretations out of this. So I'm going to make certain drastic simplifications, and those are as follows. EA is equal to EB is equal to TAA and TBB. Both I'm going to take them to be zero. Okay, so remember this, these two were nearest neighbor overlaps of the atomic orbitals, and these two were the reference energy values or the atomic energy values. So I'm taking the reference energy to be equal to zero. Okay, so that is a general thing to do, but this is an approximation, which is I'm taking that the nearest neighbor overlaps are zero. Okay, it does not make too much of a difference. And you can check that. But essentially, the other thing that I'm assuming is that all these atoms are identical. So you can think of it as, for example, a mono wire or a nano wire of gold atoms. Okay. So people can make these monatomic, sorry, not monatomic, what is that called? Not even monolayer, but it's like a 1D chain of atoms. Okay. But the atoms are exactly the same. So, for example, you can make one single chain of gold atoms. Okay, so that is now possible. and people have copper atoms, for example, and people have done experiments with those. So you can think of it in that way, except that here I am going to take the hopping between the intra-unit cell and the inter-unit cell to be alternating, T1, T2. Okay. So if it is inter-unit cell, I will take it as T1. And the inter-unit cell is what I'm calling the diagonal. Okay. So this is intra-unit cell, and this is inter-unit cell. And this is what we are calling the off-diagonal, inter-unit cell. Okay. And TAB diagonal is equal to TBA diagonal. I'm going to call it T1, and TAB off diagonal and TBA off diagonal, I'm going to call it T2. Okay. So with this simplification, the final result that I get is what I'm going to write here. EK is plus or minus square root of T1 squared plus T2 squared plus 4T1T2 cos 2KA. Okay, so this is what I get. Okay, now let me see. Suhas, are you online?
Yes, sir.
Yeah, so Suhas, you see the dispersion that I have written, right?
Hello.
Do you see the dispersion that I have written?
EK is equal to plus R.
Yeah, that's the one. Yeah. So for a 1D monatomic lattice, what I had got was this minus 2T cos KA. Okay.
Okay.
Now for this dispersion, what is the periodicity in K? Can you tell me?
Minus pi by A to plus pi by
A. Correct. So what is the periodicity in K? It's 2 pi, right? 2 pi by,
yes,
a.
Yes, 2 pi.
Correct. 2 pi by a is the periodicity of this dispersion. Yes. But what about this dispersion here? For this diatomic lattice, what is the dispersion? What is the periodicity? I'm sorry. Is it the same?
Oh, no, it is not the
same. What is it? You're right. The answer is right. It's not the same. So if it is not the same, then what is the periodicity?
To find that.
Sorry?
One second.
Huh.
So it is pi by
A.
Yeah.
Correct. It's pi by A and not 2 pi by A, right?
Yes.
Can you tell me why is this? Why is the periodicity become half of the 1D lattice, of the monatomic 1D lattice?
Maybe because here we are having two atoms in one unit cell.
Yes, very good. So what we are doing here is that this is A, this is B, this is A, this is B, and this is A, and this is also A, right? Yeah. So the unit cell here, if this is the unit cell, then the periodicity of this lattice, the lattice parameter of this is actually 2A.
Yes.
This is the lattice parameter. So the Brillouin zone, where will it go from? I mean, what will be the minimum value? What are the Brillouin zone edges now?
Pi by 2A to minus pi by 2A.
Be very careful. Are you? Is it pi by 2A, 2 pi by 2A? You're sure?
Pi by 2A.
Yes. So pi by 2A and minus pi by 2A.
Minus pi by 2A. Yes.
Very nice. Okay. Now, given this, you can see here that there are two bands because there is plus and minus.
Yes.
Okay. And given these two bands, can you tell me what is going to be the minimum value of the plus band? So let's call this EK plus and EK minus. Okay. And the EK plus is basically T1 squared plus T2 squared plus 4T1T2 cos 2KA. Okay. And EK minus is minus of that. And the question we are asking is there going to be a band gap between these two, or are these two going to overlap? So it's possible, right, that a certain band I mean, you get these two solutions, but in certain regions of the K space, they could, for example, there could be an overlap. They could be crossing each other. Okay. And we want to find out whether they can cross each other or not. Okay. So can you tell me what is the minimum value of the EK plus band?
Minimum will be pi, k is equal to pi by 2a.
Very good. That's because you are saying that at that value, cos 2ka will become equal to -1, correct?
-1, yeah.
Yes. So when it becomes -1, then t1 squared plus t2 squared minus 4t1 t2.
So t1 minus t2, it will be ek plus is equal to t1 minus t2.
So there is a 4t1 t2 that I'm getting. So it's not exactly t1 minus t2 whole squared. I think I made some mistake. It's probably a 2 here. I will verify that later. Okay. There's, I think, a 2.
Yes.
Yeah. So then it will be mod of t1 minus t2.
Yes.
Right. So let's say that this is mod of t1 minus t2, and that's the value at the Brillouin zone edge.
Yes.
Right. And what about the center?
T1 plus T2.
T1 plus T2, and that's going to be a maximum, right?
Yes.
Very good. So the band should look something like this. Okay, this is the plus band. Yes. And since it is symmetric with respect, this is an even function with respect to the K, it should look something like this, correct?
Yes.
Okay. And now let's find out what happens to the minus band. So for the minus band, can I just reflect this about the x-axis?
Yes.
Yes, right? So yes. The maximum value will be minus of mod T1 minus T2. And that again happens at the Brillouin zone edges. So this will be exactly like this. You agree?
Yes.
Very nice. Okay. So this is what we get. Now, these are the two bands, the plus band and the minus band. Okay. Yes. And you can see that at the reference energy from which we started out, there are no states. Correct?
Yes. Yes.
So there is a conduction band and a valence band, so to say, right? And what is the minimum band gap now?
Minimum band gap is mod T1 minus T2 minus mod T1 minus T2.
Very nice. So why am I saying minimum band gap? Because for every K value, there is a gap between the two bands, yes, which is actually dependent on what K you are considering.
Yes.
Correct. So the minimum band gap is at K, at the Brillouin zone edges, and that is given by the band gap, which is the minimum, is equal to twice of T1 minus T2.
Minus T2. Yeah.
Right. What is the bandwidth here? What is the bandwidth of the plus band?
Plus band is T1 plus T2 minus T1 plus
T2. That's correct. So T1 plus T2 minus mod of T1 minus T2.
Yeah.
Right? So that is the bandwidth. And that is exactly the same for the lower one also. Okay.
Yes.
So the bandwidth is the same. And then the maximum band gap is at the Brillouin zone center. Correct?
Yeah.
Okay. So what we can see from here, so you can mute yourself, Swas. Thanks. So what we can see from here is that if we had a diatomic lattice, then we see the formation of two different bands, and there is a band gap between the two, and the band gap is happening, the minimum band gap is happening at the Brillouin zone edge. Okay. And remember, in the case of the Kronig-Penney model also, we saw something very similar, right? In the Kronig-Penney model, the ansatz that we had taken was the plane wave ansatz, right? So we had expanded the wave function in terms of plane waves in the Kronig-Penney model. So in the Kronig-Penney model, we started out with a solution which we expanded in terms of the free electron problem, whereas in the tight binding approach, we started out by expanding in terms of the atomic orbitals, which are localized, Okay, so the chronic penny model and the tight binding approach in some sense are two extremes. And also what I want to point out is that there is a huge similarity between the phonon problem and the electron problem, right? In the phonon problem, we got branches, right? And depending on how many atoms are there in the basis and how many dimensions are there, you will get that many number of branches. Similarly, here also, you can get that many number of bands and that many number of, that many number of bands, right? So it depends on what is the dimension you are in. It depends on how many atoms are there in the basis and so on. Okay. So any questions so far?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, here T1 and T2 will always be real.
Yes, good question. T1 and T2 can become complex. And what I have done here is that I've taken them to be real. Okay. But in any problem, what will happen is that if you look at the determinant, right, there is a T diagonal AB, and the counterpart to that is actually T diagonal BA, correct? So that is actually the complex conjugate.
Yes.
Yeah. So when you do solve for this determinant, you will actually get a mod of the e to the power ika t diagonal ab plus e to the power minus ika t ab off diagonal. And indeed, they can be complex, okay, with some non-trivial phase factors. But it turns out that if you look at the eigenvalue problem, right, then you will only get the modulus of the t diagonal ab times e to the power ika plus e to the power minus ika times t ab off diagonal. And if the phase factors are common between the diagonal and the off diagonal, then you can take them out and again you can get something real. Okay. But in general, I agree that they can be complex and they can introduce certain extra terms into the dispersion. Sure. And that is what actually the density functional theory does. Density functional theory calculates all these things from first principles. Okay, so it calculates, for example, it starts from a basis where the full form of the atomic orbital is taken. All these matrix elements are calculated. The delta U is calculated. And then you find out these matrix elements and do the whole algebra. Okay, so there are different methods, actually. One method is called, for example, there's something called quantum espresso, which does something that we did in the chronic penny model. That is, it starts from plane waves. It starts from the free electron problem. There is another method called the LMTO, called linear Muffin-Tin orbital method. And there is a more modern extension to it called the NMTO, okay, Muffin-Tin orbital. Now these Muffin-Tin orbitals are actually localized orbitals. So there are different methods in the community, and these different methods differ from each other on what kind of basis they choose for the starting problem or as the non-interacting problem. Okay, so yes, indeed, they can be complex, but for most model Hamiltonian problems, we choose them to be real, and we assume that taking them to be complex will not introduce any qualitatively new physics. They could give you some quantitative changes, but qualitatively, they might not make a huge difference. You won't get a new phenomenon, for example. That's what we assume. Okay.
Okay, sir.
Yes,
sir. I have a question.
Yes,
sir. While doing those density functional theory or something, sir, yes, what form do they assume for delta U? Means what type of interaction? What would be mathematical form or something? Can you discuss?
Very interesting. Yeah. So there are many different forms that people have evolved over the years. See, one example that I can give you is something called the Lennard-Jones potential. Have you heard of the Lennard-Jones potential?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So you might have seen, these kind of potentials. I'll just draw this. Have you seen something like this?
Yes, sir.
Right. So 1 over r to the power 12 six. Minus 1 yes. over r to the power 6, something like this. Right. Yes. So this could be one of those forms. Now, in general, what happens is that for different kinds of atoms, the interatomic potential has to be calculated from first principles. It is not as simple as this. This is just a model form. Okay. And in fact, there is a course offered by Professor Umesh Vaghmare called Computational Material Science, in which he actually shows you how to calculate these interatomic potentials, okay, starting from using density functional theory.
We have that course in the next semester.
Correct. So if you attend that course, you should be able to see. I am not completely sure whether one can get these in closed form or not. Okay. There are well-developed numerical methods which can give you the potential as a function of distance, and you can even plot them and visualize them. But I don't think that there are precise closed form expressions for all kinds of atoms. So what I mean is, if you're considering a sodium crystal, you will need interatomic potentials between sodium and sodium. Okay. But if you're considering, let's say, a sodium chloride crystal, then you will need interatomic potentials between sodium and chlorine. Right. And not just that, depending on what kind of environment there is, the potential between two different atoms could be different. Okay. So what I mean is that, let's say you're considering graphene versus graphite. Okay. The carbon-carbon potential might not be the same in both of these. So I don't know. I don't think there are closed form expressions. But certainly numerically one can calculate them quite
so,
well. Yeah.
So how is one guaranteed that how close we are? Actually, there will be no any experiment which can prove that how accurate we are doing any particular theory.
You're right. So what one can do is, one can find out the dispersion, let's say this Ek versus K using density functional theory. Okay. Then to verify that, there are experiments which are called angle resolved photo emission spectroscopy, okay, or photo emission spectroscopy, which is the integrated version. And using this angle resolved photo emission spectroscopy, you can extract the full electron dispersion, okay, this Ek versus K, and then compare it with what you get from the band structure.
Okay.
So that is indeed verifiable. And not only that, there are actually, the density functional theory gives you a lot of properties. Yes. It gives you properties like susceptibility, it gives you properties, thermodynamic properties, it gives you reflection coefficient, transmission coefficient, polarization, all kinds of properties.
Do anyone here in JNC nothing?
Yes, so there are, in fact, JNC is extremely strong in density functional theory based calculations. So
for experimental?
Experimental, no. So the DFT is a theoretical technique.
Yes, sir.
But experimentally, nobody in JNC is doing photo emission spectroscopy.
Okay.
Or angle resolved photo emission. The people who are doing, I know one person in TIFR who is Kaloburan Maithi, who is doing that. And then in IASC, DD Sharma practices that. And there are probably very few groups in India who are doing angle resolved photo emission. That's okay. A very direct observation, but there are many indirect observations also.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sure. Okay. So this was about the dispersion, and I'll just give you a hint of what we are going to do next time. We will take these dispersions, and as we did for the phonons, we will calculate the density of states. And this density of states is something that is again measurable, okay? And the density of states turns out to be a crucial quantity in determining transport and thermodynamics and so on, okay? So we will do exactly the same thing as we did for phonons. We will take the Ek, and we will find out D of E is sum over K delta of E minus Ek. So many of you might be familiar with this way of finding the finding the density of states for the free electron case. You try to find out the n of E and then take the dn by dE, and that gives you the density of states. Okay, and finding the n of E for a free electron dispersion is quite easy, because you know that it is basically a sphere. The constant energy surface is a sphere in K space. And from that, one can find out how many states are enclosed within the n of E, and then one can find out the derivative. Okay, but this method does not work if the EK is more complicated than a quadratic dispersion. Okay, so if the EK, for example, for the monatomic 1D lattice, we got minus 2T cos KA. So 1D monatomic lattice. And for this, if I want to apply exactly the same method, then it becomes extremely complicated. I can't even find out what is N of E. Okay, so to find out the density of states for this kind of a dispersion, we have to know some properties of this Dirac delta function. Okay, so I think we had done some properties of that when we were doing phonons, but in any case, we will go over those once again. So I will stop here today, and if there are any more questions, I can take them, or otherwise we can stop.
Sir?
Yes.
Sir, in monatomic 1D lattice, can you just repeat?